My name is Eric Strebel. I'm an industrial designer. Welcome to my channel about product design and making. I hope that you like, enjoy, and become a subscriber. Make sure you give the video a thumbs up, and then you hit the bell. Hit the bell again so you get the little parentheses around it. That way you'll be notified every time I have a new video. In this video, we're going to take a look at the continued design process of finishing this foam wireless charger mock-up. In the previous video, we got to where we are here. I'm going to take the electronics out so that we can finish the foam and get it to that nice shiny surface that we want. We're going to start by fixing any imperfections in the foam. I'm going to use like a little bit of polyester body filler. I'm going to do a little Bondo squeeze, sand it flat. I've already got a coat of primer on it. So we're going to continue this finishing process of adding primer onto the foam to build up a nice candy shell that we can finish and ultimately paint. I have previous videos about finishing and painting stuff, so I'm not going to spend too much time in this video talking about the specific details. If you haven't seen that video yet, you'll want to go back to the video. It's called How to Get a Fantastic Finish on Your Bondo Model. The process is roughly the same. We're applying primer using spot putty to fill any holes or gaps or any imperfections, and adding primer on there to build up again that candy shell, and we're wet sanding in between coats. We're starting off at like about a 220 grit, and then we're finishing that off to like a 400 or 600. Here there's a little hole detail inside the foam that I don't want, and I'm using some polyester body filler, some glazing putty to fill that in. And then it got a little too hard on me, and I need to Dremel it out a little bit. And you're saying, whoa, Eric, why are you painting this dark primer on your part here all of a sudden? How come you're not using that medium gray that allows you to see the surface really well? Well, part of the process of designing is checking out different color options. I want to see what this thing looks like in a dark finish, and I happen to have some gray primer that's giving me the opportunity to see what this mock-up is going to look like in gray. I'm also printing out a little ring. This ring ideally would be lit, but I'm sticking with the existing hardware, so in an ideal situation, we'd have a little light up ring when you put the charger, the phone on the charger. In this case, I'm going to add a colored ring to add a little bit of detail and tell the user a little bit about how to use this device with that colored ring. I'm hoping that gives some indication that the top rotates to make it a little bit more obvious about the adjustability of the device. All right, I'm going to switch back to the regular medium gray primer, and we're going to give it a nice uniform coat, and we're going to start our CMF process. So the color, material, and finish process. We started that a little bit by painting it the dark gray. I really kind of like that. So I want to explore a little bit further about what this object could look like in different colors and finishes. We're going to take a photograph and pull it into an image editor here, and we're just going to cut out the sections so that we can color them in and see what this object would look like in different colors. So once it's all cut out and everything, now I can start to easily adjust those colors. And here's some of the color variations that I'm doing for the different materials and finishes. I'm mainly exploring color options, not big material options. In a real design situation, I might do several dozens of these, exploring different materials, finishes, plastics. In this case, I think the model should probably be made out of metal if it was a product for production, maybe with a little glass top at the top. I'm exploring a little blue sort of aqua ring. I happen to have two colors of that. One's a little bit darker than the other. I'm attaching them onto a cup, and I'm just spraying these out, and then we're going to be able to test that out with whatever the final color is on the charger that we go with. So we're going to have some options. And this is pretty standard procedure for design process. So a little bit more spot putty on the bottom piece. It's actually a lot. Things aren't going well for that piece. The top, however, is a different story. It's coming right along really good. Here I'm just sanding the top edge and fillet of the piece, probably with about 400 grit wet dry sandpaper. So that piece looks like it's about ready to paint, and I'm pretty happy with that. The bottom, on the other hand, is turning out to be a complete disaster. Have no idea why, what's going on. It's getting a lot of bubbling. The paint was never getting hard. It was staying soft. Something very unusual. I don't really see that. Sometimes that's caused by moisture, but I really have no way of knowing that. So I'm going to put a skim coat of glazing putty on the foam just to seal it up and move the process along, because I'm starting to run out of time here to make my weekly video. And I don't want to miss my Wednesday drop time here. So drastic times called for drastic measures. Skim coating this. It is a convex surface. If it was a concave surface, I probably wouldn't be able to skim coat it and finish it this way. It'd be a lot harder. It's also a good time to spray out some little sample panels. So when I spray out these panels here, again, light coats of primer, and in the color material finish process, you want to be able to see the colors. Depending upon the demographics that you were designing for, you would explore these different color options as we did earlier. I also need to build a sticky ring for the top of the charger so that the phone can stay on at any angle. You remember we cut this at a 25 degrees, and here in this situation, I put a template on there and it's 65 degrees and the math works out. So we're going to print out the 3D printed template, and that's going to be used to cut my sticky pad. So we'll take the model out of CAD and we'll bring it into Cura, and we'll print it on the Ultimaker real quick, and we'll use this as a template. And this will allow us to get a really nice part, at least the best that we can. The bottom's looking pretty good here. I'm just putting on light coats of primer and things are progressing well. So I should be able to finish without the issues I was having before. Here's the printed out template, and you can kind of roughly see where that sticky pad is going to go on the top. Also gives you an idea of how big that ring is going to be. If you needed to make it bigger or smaller, you could just reprint that 65 degree oval to get it correct. Using a very sharp X-Acto, and I'm cutting out my sticky pad here. It's something I purchased commercially on eBay. It's about 2-3 millimeters thick. And there's our 65 degree piece. You can roughly see how it's going to fit onto the top and hold the phone in place. I think it's important to note at this point that, you know, we're making a foam model. Many people ask, why are we not going with a 3D printed model? At this stage of the design process, you would go through many iterations of design variations. Building stuff in the computer at this point is way too limiting. It's just quicker, faster to make stuff out of foam. Maybe later on in the process when you start to have to deal with, you know, plastic production, you know, snaps, connections, things to hold stuff inside. 3D printing is great for that kind of stuff. But early on in the design process, I like to make my stuff by hand. Gives me a much better connection to the product and gives me much greater flexibility in designing the product. All right, so I'm making really good progress on the base piece, and I was able to catch up and get that to the same finish as the top. I'm going to use a little wax and grease remover solvent here on the part, and I'm just going to clean the part really nice so we don't have any issues when we are painting. And I highly recommend something like this. You could use something like a tack cloth or whatever, but I find the solvent works a little bit better. So I'm laying down a very light coat of our base coat here, and we're going to do the several coats of that. I've picked out kind of a dark gray. It seems to have a sort of bluish or purple tint, at least when it goes down like this. And we start to build up those light coats. And this is the top piece here. Again, light little coats. Let it dry in between coats, and then I come back. You don't want to do all this work and then mess up your paint. So nice light coats, just like we've done with the primer. build up that surface so we don't mess anything up. All right, you want to wear a mask at this point. I am using an automotive-based urethane clear coat. I buy this stuff at an automotive supply refinisher, so not at an O'Reilly's or something like that. And here I am, I'm just acting like a complete amateur, dumping the stuff out. And I put in the activator, and it almost instantly chews through the polystyrene cup. So let's try that again with a regular plastic cup that is not going to be affected by the activator. So this is a two-part urethane, very much like a urethane plastic that you see me use all the time, but this is specially made for automotive, and this is what's going to give you that beautiful gloss finish. I'm putting the stuff into an HVLP gun, testing out the spray, and I'm going to lay down my clear coat on my part. So nice little light coats. You can see there's a lot of overspray here from the gun. You definitely want to have a spray booth or a very well ventilated area if you're doing something like this. But this urethane clear coat is what they put on a car. It is going to give you that fantastic clear coat, much, much better than what you're going to get out of a rattle can. Here's the bottom piece. Again, nice light coats. And I do two coats on each of the piece to get a really nice clear top coat.
So something we haven't addressed in this series very much is production materials. I think this could be a higher end product ranging in the $50 to $75 range for retail, probably machined out of steel or aluminum, possibly stock tubing. This would be the next part of the process that you would go through in a project like this if you chose this concept and you chose to move forward, would be designing for a specific manufacturing process. There's a few things that need to be changed. There's no charging in the full vertical position due to the location of the wireless charging on the phone, so the charger would have to be adjusted. Ideally, the connection and the LEDs need to go in the bottom half or in the ring so that they don't move with the entire design, but that's part of the design process.